The Queen's Gambit is an incredible new show on Netflix. It has received rave reviews from almost everyone and has been number one on Netflix in 27 different countries. The show tells the story of a young chess prodigy, Beth Harmon. By the end of the show, Beth, perfectly played by Anya Taylor-Joy, is a young woman ascending the highest heights of chess. The show has incredible writing and dialogue, production value and costuming, and most of all, great performances. Additionally, the show gets chess right. The mannerisms, terminology, and atmosphere of chess are nearly perfectly captured. This is not just fan service for chess players. It makes for more immersive and compelling storytelling. However, across the nearly 7 hours of the show, there are a few chess errors. In this video, we are going to break down those errors.
That isn't one you taught me.
So?
But is that one of those things, like the Sicilian defense?
Those things are called openings.
Is that one of them?
Yes. The Queen's Gambit.
In general, the show does a great job accurately referencing chess openings and other chess terminology. And the chess terminology does a great job of not being pointless and showy. Instead, it supplements the story by helping to immerse the viewer in the niche world of chess. This is a rare exception where the terminology is incorrect and stands out. The Queen's Gambit is 1d4, d5, and 2c4. Or in the descriptive notation of the show, pawn to queen 4, pawn to queen 4 by black, and pawn to queen bishop 4. In the video, one can see that only the first move, 1d4, has been played. The gambit in the Queen's Gambit, the sacrifice of the bishop's pawn for more activity and central control, has not yet been played. Now, this is a nitpicky point, but the show is called The Queen's Gambit. So it would have been good to get this detail right.
Beth, take a look at this. It's White's move. What would you do?
Typical mid-game Ruy Lopez.
Well, yeah, we know that, but what's the move? You see?
Maybe you're right.
I know I'm right. And Beth sees things the same way I do. Pawn move's too weak, right?
The pawn move only works if he plays his bishop.
Exactly.
Bye, boys.
Whoa, hold on. How about some speed chess? Or we could play some Skittles, or Blitz, or Bug House.
So, speed chess and Blitz chess are close to synonyms. Speed chess is a little bit broader than Blitz chess. In modern chess, most would say that rapid chess is games with 30 minutes per side down to about 10 minutes per side. Blitz chess is 10 minutes per side down to about 3 minutes per side, and bullet chess is less than 3 minutes per side. All of these can be considered speed chess. Skittles, on the other hand, refers to friendly games, games that are not rated, not part of a tournament, not part of a match. These games are usually blitz chess games again. In context, this is a little bit like asking if someone wants to play poker, and then when they say no, you ask them if they want to play Texas Hold'em. The sentence just rings off to chess players. Now, Bug House is different, and it refers to a doubles version of chess in which captured pieces are given to a teammate and they can be placed back in play on unoccupied squares. Later, there is a blitz chess simul that is one of my favorite scenes in the show, but I also think that it's not realistic. I just don't think that any player in history, not Bobby Fischer, not Magnus Carlsen, not Garry Kasparov, could play three strong players, two of them grandmasters, at the same time in blitz chess and succeed. There's simply not enough time to move the pieces and play moves of any quality. But I would love, love to see Magnus Carlsen attempt this feat and prove me wrong.
As far as they knew, Harmon's level of play wasn't up to theirs. Someone like Liev probably didn't spend a lot of time preparing for their match. Elizabeth Harmon's not at all an important player by their standards. The only unusual thing about her, really, is her sex. And even that's not unique in Russia. There's Nona Gaprindashvili, but she's the female world champion and has never faced men.
This is probably the one error in the show that truly does trouble me. Nona Gaprindashvili is the first female grandmaster in history, and she absolutely played and crushed men. It's true that she was never able to compete evenly at the very highest level of chess, as Beth is shown to be doing here, but she is a truly great and inspirational player. People often ask why chess has separate competitions for men and women, since both genders can compete equally, unlike in physical sports like basketball and swimming. It's important to note that there is no tournament that female players are excluded from. The Queen's Gambit does accurately depict that there are competitions available exclusively to female players, the US Women's Championship and the Women's World Championship, for example. Whether those tournaments are a benefit to female chess or not is something that is hotly debated by female players. But any woman can compete in any tournament, and you see in the show that Beth does compete and dominate at the highest levels of chess, and other women have done so as well. Something that's probably not fully depicted is the degree of sexism that Beth would likely have experienced at this particular time at the highest level of chess. When Vera Menchik, the first female world champion in 1929, played in a super tournament, the Viennese master Becker suggested that anyone who lost to her should be granted membership in the Menchik Club. He became the first member when he lost to her. Many other famous and excellent players were later added to this club as well. At the same time that Beth Harmon is ascending the chess heights in the show, Bobby Fischer, in a 1963 CBC interview, said of women, "They're terrible chess players. I guess they're just not so smart. I don't think that they should mess into intellectual affairs. They should keep strictly to the home." Now, obviously, these sentences are horrible. I can only say that Bobby Fischer certainly had undiagnosed and untreated mental illness, and some of the horrible things that he said can be attributed to that. However, this kind of sentiment is not nearly as uncommon for the time period in chess as I wish it was. There is a karmic justice in the fact that Bobby Fischer's record as the youngest grandmaster of all time was surpassed 34 years later by a woman, Judit Polgár, in arguably the greatest female player of all time and one of the greatest players of all time by any measure.
Beth, listen to me. You gotta open up that file, okay?
How do I do that?
There are four ways, depending on what he does, and we've each been working a way through. So do you have it handy?
Yes, I do, yes.
Great, okay, well, let's start with his knight to rook four. We push that king, knight, pawn. You got that?
Yes.
Great, I'll pass you back to Harry.
Okay, there are three things you might do now. So after the queen to knight three, you play knight to king six. Then if he plays rook to rook five, then you play pawn to king three.
Another variation, if he plays
knight takes pawn on king five, then you take the rook.
But if he plays rook to rook seven, check, then play rook to bishop two.
It's very Hollywood to have all of these players assembled together in New York City in Benny's apartment for the dramatic finale. But setting aside my suspension of disbelief regarding the fact that all of these players are together in a city in which only one of them lives, some of these players are just going to get in the way. Adjournment analysis is rigorous and intensive. You can see that Borgov is working with other former world champions, and some of the players here just aren't going to be contributing. I'm sorry, but anything that Matt and Mike see is going to be probably fraught with error, and if it's accurate, then Benny Watts could probably spot it in a split second. Now, aside from that, the depiction of adjournment analysis is really, really good. It is absolutely true that in the past, serious games would be interrupted for adjournment, and you would have entire teams that would help you analyze the position.
It's your game. Take it.
I've seen a lot of chess players comment on the constant tipping of the king to end the game in the show. Now, this is something that chess players do, but it's relatively uncommon. Much more common is simply offering a handshake to your opponent to signal that you are resigning the game. In fact, the act of resignation is basically always a foregone conclusion. Between serious players, both players know that the game is over and that one player has been defeated before the handshake is offered. And in fact, the show does a great job depicting that. Throughout the show, it's clear that both players have accepted the conclusion before the game is actually ended. Now, I guess it's not illegal to hug your opponent after the game, but I've never seen it happen, and I have to think it would be a little bit inappropriate. I hope that you've enjoyed this video. This series is so, so good. I love absolutely everything about it, particularly the chess, of course, but also Anya Taylor-Joy's performance. The last video I had a chance to see in theaters before COVID was Emma. She also starred in that, and my wife and I both thoroughly enjoyed that show. If you have other thoughts on different inaccuracies or just general comments on the show, then please do leave them in the comments here to this YouTube video. And if you want to see other videos on this channel, then simply click on the playlist that is popping up on your screen as we speak.